5 things that you can buy for under $20 that give you better results in language learning and make the time you spend learning more enjoyable. Number 1, a Bluetooth adapter for non-Bluetooth compatible devices such as an older car or a stereo in your living room. I have a few of these because I have multiple speakers and receivers around my house, and a $15 Bluetooth adapter means that when I'm doing the washing up or cooking, I can throw on an audiobook without the hassle of plugging things in and whatnot, and I can save myself like $700-$800 on a new amplifier that would essentially do the same thing as the ones I've got, but with Bluetooth. You probably know that you can also get them for cars. A lot of cars that aren't even that old will have the auxiliary in, but not the Bluetooth in. Shana chicos, my name's Lamont, I'm Australian, so just a side note, when I'm saying under $20, I mean US dollars. So if you see screenshots that are saying like $30, that's $30 Australian. Point is, they're reasonably cheap, and most of the things on this list didn't exist even a few years ago, or certainly weren't that cheap. Language learners back then would have killed to get access to the stuff that we have now, so let's do it. Also, some of them will be linked in the description. They're Amazon affiliate links. I'll try to use the US version so that they work easily for most of you. If you have to buy it somewhere else, or you want to buy it, or you've already got something that'll do the same job that you hadn't thought of and you don't get it from that link, it's totally fine. If you're going to get them from Amazon anyway and you happen to use one of those links, that's cool. Second thing on the list, and don't worry, we're going to get to stuff that you haven't thought of. I use these a disproportionately large amount of the time for how much they cost. Ta-da! Bluetooth headphones. Now, this particular set I find to be absolutely excellent. I've had them for about a year and a half or so and they cost me $30 Australian, but these particular ones are not available anymore. So I'm holding the last pair in the world. But that's okay, because I use these for absolutely everything. They've become like keys, phone, wallet, headphones. And one thing that they're good for, but maybe not as good as they could be, is running, where I find I have to push them back in a lot or they fall out. So I got these ones for $32 Australian, I think. I haven't had a chance to go for a run in them yet, but I think they will be better for that. They're already staying in my ears better. I have had a listen to them. I'd say the audio quality is not quite as good, but when we're talking about language learning application, podcast, audiobooks, that kind of thing, that doesn't really matter. That's really a music thing. And the reason that Bluetooth earbuds, which obviously everyone knows about, are on this list is that I think a lot of language learners just kind of haven't thought of that, or they haven't gotten around to buying them or whatever. It's just something that gives you an extra half an hour, maybe even 2 hours a day of immersion, because you just throw them on and suddenly you've got an audiobook or a podcast. They're a really good thing. Okay, so now getting to one that you might be like, wait, you can do that? That's right. For $29.81 Australian, I ordered this microphone. Now, not to brag or anything, but I already have a microphone, a couple of them actually. I'm not really sure why I bother though, because here is the audio on the most viewed video of my channel.
What results I've had from using Duolingo every day for over 800 days. That's a little over 2 years.
So you know all those make better YouTube video kind of channels that go like, you need good audio. No, you don't. You do not need good audio. You do not need on-screen presence, good lighting, good coloring, nothing. You just need a thumbnail of you beating up the Duolingo owl. So anyway, I have a quality microphone, the one that you're listening to this video through, and I mainly used it to make videos, but I was pleasantly surprised to find that it has a real-time headphone outlet. Now, what this means is that you can listen to yourself talk the way you would sound to other people, but in real time. In older times, like 2009, 2010 or so, this would often come with some sort of delay, but no, this is real time. But at the time, I just thought, okay, not that big a deal. I already had equipment that could do that if I really wanted to. It's still sort of annoying to set up for a language learning application, but no, it's not. Because there was something that I noticed but never thought about the application of. When the microphone is plugged into the computer, you can select the microphone to also be the speakers or the sound outlet of the computer. And at the time I thought, why would I want to do that? I've got speakers, I've got headphones, I don't need the microphone to also play the sound for me. Do I? So this whole time, an incredible potential use for a microphone like this completely passed me by, because what happens when you select the microphone as the speakers is it plays the computer's sound through headphones that are plugged into the microphone if you have them plugged in. But what I didn't realize is that it doesn't disable your voice. So you're hearing your voice through the microphone as it would sound to other people, as well as whatever is coming through the computer. Now, the streaming and gaming and podcasting and whatever nerds out there are going,
yeah, well, that's because of the levels.
Yeah, I get that. But the language learning nerds out there are thinking, real time shadowing.
In my opinion, the ideal shadowing setup actually costs a good bit of money to acquire.
That was Matt versus Japan just under 5 years ago. And because of the limits of the technology available at the time, he's basically just describing a more complex and more expensive way to do this exact thing. I did not realize that you can simply do this with a USB microphone with a headphone outlet. A $20 USB microphone. Now, full disclosure, this $19 one that I just got is not as high quality as my good one. If it had been as high quality, I'd have been very annoyed. It's very quiet, even with the volume turned all the way up. It weighs about as much as Logan Paul's credibility. And it only records in mono, which if you're doing the sort of stuff that I'm doing, just adds an extra step. For language learning, it's exactly the same. And the reason that I actually had to buy it for this video was that I was convinced that there was no way a $19 microphone was going to have, for language learning purposes, exactly the same functionality. It can, guys, it's exactly the same. Plus it comes with a 2 meter long USB-C cable, which is actually a pretty handy thing in and of itself, given that the one they give you with your phone is like half an inch. And if you're still not convinced that this could help you learn a language, it comes with a novella in 5 languages. So yeah, this is definitely not a good microphone, a quality microphone. I'm glad I have my one, but for language learning applications, this is the same thing. And by the way, if you don't want to get this one or you can't get this one, any USB microphone that has a headphone outlet should do the job. Don't get the Blue Yeti. They suck ass.
To get a Blue Yeti mic, for the love of God, please stop buying these. They are such shit mics for the price.
She's right. You know what? I can tell when YouTubers are using a Blue Yeti.
Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. What do you think of my audio quality? Is it good?
But if the microphone instruction manual in 5 languages doesn't float your boat, picky, then have you heard of books? Ordinary books.
Yes.
An ordinary book in your target language. It doesn't matter what level you're at. You can always use a book, even if you can't actually read with enough fluency to have some idea of what's going on. Choose a few words and look them up. Now, obviously what a book in your target language costs will depend on a number of factors, but I have so many books here in both Spanish and Swedish that I've paid like $2 Australian for. But I know that most of you are in the US or the UK. Go to a used bookshop or a thrift store, look for stuff. If you're learning like Spanish, Italian, German, that kind of thing, that you will find one, I'm sure you will. And the good thing is that the further you are away from reading fluency in your target language, the more that just any book will do the job, because you just need a collection of words in the same place. That's what it is at the beginning. As my Swedish has gotten better and better, I've realized more and more how many of my Swedish books I'm just not gonna read because I'm not interested in them. If you don't have a printed book in your target language, please get one. Just a quick bonus one, it doesn't count to one of the 5 on the list, but I paid $7 for this balance board. This is really handy for just if you need a break from sitting down, if you've been listening to your target language, or maybe you've been working and then you wanna watch a YouTube video in your target language, throw this on the floor. It's just a very simple balance board. It doesn't require a huge amount of balance or skill or anything like that. It uses more energy when you're standing on this than just standing normally. It's very good for you to spend a little bit of time standing on something like this every day, and you can do that while you listen to your language. And that brings us to number 5, an old smartphone or tablet. Now, I know that technically smartphones and tablets are certainly not $20, but let's be real, a lot of us are onto our 7th or 8th smartphone by now. And for a lot of us, one of those ones that we've moved on from because Apple's deliberately slowed it down or whatever's happened to it, it can still work for this application. Now, if it's properly broken, like it just doesn't turn on or the screen's cracked or whatever, please recycle it at a proper phone recycling center, because phones have rare metals in them that companies will mine, and in order to do that, they clear rainforests. So we can play a very small part in reducing that by recycling our phones properly. But if you've got one that does still work, at least partially, and you wanna keep using it, here's how you can use it for language learning. For one thing, you can have a phone that is just for language learning. So all the distracting things, email, messenger, Instagram, all that sort of stuff is just not installed or disabled. That's what I use this one for. It's essentially just a really good MP3 player. Ordinary MP3 players don't allow all kinds of apps. So I never found an MP3 player that I could put, say, Storytel on. I can put Storytel on this because it's just a phone, but it also has a bigger screen. It's much cheaper than an MP3 player. It's just a win-win-win-win-win-win. Okay, that's enough. Because I like running, I happen to have a fancy running watch that has MP3 capability, but sometimes I haven't loaded anything onto the watch before I go for a run. So instead, I'll just take this phone. No one can bother me on it because I don't actually have a telephone on it. So I can't get calls or emails or anything like that. I've just got my Storytel books with me. I've got it like an MP3 player. It's really handy. Every person's situation is different, so I'm sure that some people can think of a use for an old phone in language learning that isn't one of the ones I've named here. Another one I have heard of that's maybe a bit more niche is to have one phone that is entirely dedicated to language learning. So it's, say, set into Spanish. They've got their Storytel Mexican account on there. Whatever, all their stuff on there is dedicated to learning Spanish. So when they're on that phone, that's kind of all they can do. Okay, that's it. Hope you learned something. Leave me a comment, subscribe, and as always, lo quiero.